so you get the idea. It's kind of like if you're in school and you draw those little stick figures in the corner of your book and you draw them in different positions, and then you kind of rifle through the book and you can see the stick figure like an animation. That's what change over time really is, according to the temporal parts. So you got the idea of temporal parts. What's the question? It's clear that that's a kind of vivid way of thinking about objects over time, kind of grab the imagination. But some people think it's the literal truth. They think that there really are these entities, these temporal parts, and there is no such thing as you being the very same over time, just as there is no such thing as you being all here at this point in space. These people think that there really exist these things, temporal parts. What you're looking at is one of them. And who we call Ted is not this temporal part, but rather the aggregate of all. Just as if who we call Ted, just like who we call Ted is not just this part of my hand, but all of them. Other people think they just don't exist temporal parts. It's the very same object here as it was when I was born in 1967, and who will be celebrating or crying or drink one way or the other in a few days. So anyways, this is a controversy. Do there or do there not exist these entities, temporal parts? So, a couple other quick examples before we get to the real world. The question of personal identity over time is also involves time, but it's a different question from the question of temporal parts because it's specific to persons. So, if you think back to something you did 3 years ago, that was you. That wasn't somebody else. Even though that person maybe had a different haircut, or differed in various ways from you, still that was you. You did something bad then. It's you we should punish. We can't punish anybody else. We can't punish your identical twin, even if they look a lot like you. This is one example, this bit about punishment, is one example of the significance of this idea of being the same person over time. Similarly, if you did something bad, you can regret it if it's something you did, but if it's something someone else did, you can't regret it in quite the same way. You can't feel proud in quite the same way. I mean, for your close friends, you can feel a kind of pride and regret for their actions, but it's not the same as if you did. So there's this idea of personal identity over time. And there's this question, well, what does it amount to? Because there are various kinds of changes which are consistent with personal identity over time. So I'm a lot bigger, my hair is different length and different color, it's still me. But if you melt me into a bucket of soup, then the soup is not me. I just stopped existing. Even though it's the same matter. So just having the same matter doesn't guarantee that you have the same person over time. And in fact, it isn't required. So because of natural processes, I presumably don't have any of the same matter that I did 20 years ago, yet it was still me. So you can see it's kind of a puzzling question. What does sameness of personal identity over time consist in? Some people think it's basically sameness of your body. And sameness of body doesn't mean exactly the same matter, but it means rather something like the matter only changes gradually over time and always keeps a person's shape, something like that. Some people think it's the body that makes you, having the same body makes you the same as over time. But there's a famous example of Locke's in which he imagines two people, a prince and a cobbler, and he imagines the memories of the cobbler going into the prince's body and the memory of the prince going into the cobbler's body. So you imagine the prince committing some horrible crime and then transplanting his memories into the body of the cobbler, and then afterwards the cobbler's body's going, ha ha ha, I got away with that, and laughing as the body of the prince with the cobbler's memories going away protesting that they didn't do anything. So thought experiment. Who do you think, was there a miscarriage of justice? Do you think that it was the prince's body we should punish? Or should we punish the cobbler's body with the prince's memory? And people who think it the latter, they think, well, that's because that is the prince. The person goes with the memories, not with the body. Here's another metaphysical controversy. Does sameness of person go along with body or memories? And then one last example involves causation, I want to talk about. So causation, the idea there is one event making another happen. So if I take a brick and I throw it through somebody's window, then my throwing the brick caused that window to shatter. And if I threw the brick at the window and some other window down the street just happened to shatter at the very same time that the window that actually caused the shatter shattered, that wouldn't be caused, even though it happened right after my throwing of the brick. Because it wasn't my throwing the brick that made that other window happen. That was a coincidence. So there's this idea of some events, processes, making others happen. That's causation. And there are a lot of philosophical questions about causation. I'll mention just one. It's a question of whether absences can be causes. So philosophers have thought about this. So the idea is, suppose that I promise to feed somebody's cat, and then I didn't, and then the cat dies. Then there's the question, well, what caused the cat to die? The natural answer is, well, it's the fact that I didn't feed the cat, my not feeding the cat. So that's a negative alleged cause. It's an absence of my feeding the cat. Or if I go into outer space and then my body explodes, what caused my body to explode? The absence of air pushing down on me. So anyways, some people think, yeah, of course, absences could be caused. Obviously, my failing to feed the cat caused the cat to die. And obviously, my being in outer space caused me to die there. But other people think, well, wait, how can absences be causes? Absences aren't even real things. They're kind of like holes. They're just absences. They aren't really real entities. Where would we say that my not feeding the cat is located? if it's an event, we should be able to locate that event in space and time, but it seems like we can't. So anyway, some people argue that absences can't be causes. So there are all these questions. And metaphysician, I mean, one thing that may strike you is that these questions seem like questions that we couldn't possibly hope to answer. Because, I mean, well, I hope you have a little bit of a reaction like that, I don't know, do we want to say that absence is going to be causes or not? I don't know, it seems like we could kind of go either way. Do we want to say that there are temporal parts or not? I can kind of see how it is a consistent description of the world to say there are all these temporal parts. But what would be a reason, one way or the other? And my main goal is actually not to get into particular metaphysical arguments and whether they're good ones, but I don't want to leave it too abstract, so I do want to give you a sense of the fact that if you work very hard at it, you can actually come up with what seem like good reasons, one way or the other. I mean, in philosophy, you never have anything, or very rarely have anything like conclusive reasons. But, you know, you can make a better or worse case. So let me give you one example of an argument about the temporal parts issue. So here's an argument that there are such things as temporal parts. So here's an example. This is an example by a philosopher named Eli Hirsch. He says, imagine a bunch of people who talk about these strange objects, in cars and out cars. So an in car is basically a car or part of a car in a garage. So the in car people, the people who talk about in cars and out cars, what they would say is, what we would describe as a car in a garage, they would say, oh, there's an in car in the garage. So you might think, well, then in car just means car. But when what we would call the car leaves the garage, they would say the in car shrinks and shrinks and shrinks, because they only call the in-car the part of the car in the garage. The in-car shrinks and then disappears. And what has happened during this process is an out-car has just started appearing out of nowhere. And then you have a whole out-car right outside the garage. And then that out-car drives around for the day. And then the out-car comes back and faces the garage. I shouldn't say pokes its nose in the garage. Faces the garage. And then starts disappearing as a corresponding in-car, maybe the same in-car as the beginning, maybe not, I guess they would have to face that question. Then an in-car appears, and then you got an in-car in your garage. So, our natural reaction, or many of us have this reaction, is that there's something very strange about this society. This society believes in these bizarre objects, in-cars and out-cars. These objects that seem to stop existing and start existing depending on this kind of not very important fact, whether they're inside a garage. But here's something to make you question that quick judgment that there's something wrong with this in-car culture, the people that talk about these in-cars. Think about an island. So we think of there being these things, islands. We care a lot about islands. But if you really think about it, if you forget about the surface of the water, an island is really just the top of a deep, of a pretty big mountain in a deep body of water. We have a word for the island because we care very much about the boundary of the water. But if there were these beings who were kind of like fish and could breathe underwater but could also fly, who were pretty much indifferent to the boundary of the water, they probably wouldn't have any use for a concept of an island. They would consider the islands to be basically no more interesting than we would consider to be the top little bit, say, above the tree, above the cloud line of a regular mountain. And these kinds of examples make you think, wait a minute, are we really right to say there really aren't any such things as in cars and out cars? If you want an objective view of the world, a view of the world that isn't just a projection of the conceptual scheme we happen to have because of the accident of our biology, we happen to not be able to breathe underwater, we can breathe above water. If we want a more objective view of the world, you might think, you should say that both in cars and out cars, as well as cars, they all exist. All these objects exist. You shouldn't privilege the cars, our objects, the objects we like to think about, over the in-car people's objects. You should say they both exist. We don't have a word for in-cars. And they do, for whatever reason, but they both exist. Similarly, both islands, as well as the tops of mountains, as well as all of the whole mountain. All these objects exist. It's just that certain people have words for certain bits of the world that they can particularly care about. And I would argue that if you take this permissive attitude towards objects far enough, then you will get the claim that that temporal parts exist. Because to get an objective picture of the world where we don't privilege the kinds of objects that we just happen to care about leads to saying that any portion of space-time, no matter what it's like, no matter what its boundaries look like, whether it's bounded in ways that we care about or not, any portion of space-time corresponds to an object, and that means that temporal parts exist. So there's a lot to talk about there. I mean, there's a lot of places where you could criticize that argument, but I hope you can see that at least there are some real considerations at work there, that we do want an objective view of the world, not just a projection of the concepts that we happen to have. And you know, I think you can see how that thought impacts the debate over temporal parts. Okay, so far what I've been talking about is some different metaphysical issues. I hope you've taken away from this that even though metaphysicians are largely working from the armchair, still they can formulate some abstract claims about the world as a whole, and can give some reasons one way or another on these debates. So next I want to talk about the real world. Are these claims really about the real world? Well, as opposed to what? I mean, isn't everything about the real world? So let me give you an example of what I mean by not being about the real world. So imagine having a big fight over whether, let's say, the Pope or Robinson Crusoe is a bachelor. Like, maybe it's obvious that the Pope is not a bachelor, I guess, or... Does anybody think the Pope is a bachelor? Okay, so what about Robinson Crusoe? Is that a hard question? Maybe that. I want something that you kind of think, oh, I'm not really sure. Or, suppose you have a... You put some water in a drinking vessel that's made of glass, and you call it glass. Is it a cup? You kind of go... Maybe not. Or in New Jersey, you can get these things. You can go to these bars, and they have 130 different kinds of martinis. And you're like, what? I thought a martini has to be made out of gin or vodka, and maybe just gin if you're a purist. But no, anything that's served in a glass like this with some sour apple liqueur, they call appletinis. That's one of their martinis. And then you can imagine getting into a big fight. An appletini's not a martini. Yes, it is. And or in the mountain example. So take the island, but now consider the whole protrusion from the ocean floor. Is that a mountain? Kind of thing.
I'm not really sure what you said.
What's that?
Oh, a sea mountain.
A sea mountain. So that's but is it a mountain? Are sea mountains mountains?
There's the, so you shrug your shoulders, which is exactly what you should do, because these questions are not questions about the real world. They're just questions about how to talk. They're just verbal questions.